If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Luke. I'll be quite honest with you tonight. Luke chapter 10, the Gospel of Luke chapter 10. I'll be honest with you, this morning I thought that I had a message to minister for tonight. And then just about an hour before I got ready to leave the house this afternoon to make my way here, the Lord started dealing with me about some other things, and I felt like He wanted me to go in a different direction than what I had previously planned. And even since then, I've felt a little different direction. You know, sometimes it's hard for us preachers just to get where the Lord wants us to be. Amen. Sometimes we're hard-headed and we try to go our own route, but I believe the Lord wants to say something tonight in spite of me. Amen. In spite of our weaknesses, in spite of our frailties, I know that God wants to speak. You know, you and I, as the body of Christ, we're simply vessels. We're vessels of the glory of God. We're vessels meet for the Master's use. That's all. There's no glory found in you and I in and of ourselves. There's nothing good in us that regards us. The only good that you'll find in me tonight is the grace of God. The only goodness you'll find in me is Jesus Christ and what He's done in my life. That's the only goodness that you'll find in me tonight. And I believe you'll say the same about yourself tonight. Amen. Luke chapter 10. We will begin reading in verse 25. We'll read quite a few verses here. We're going to read this whole passage. So just bear with me just for a moment, but I just want to read this story to bring us up to par for what we're going to be talking about tonight. Luke chapter 10, beginning in verse 25, and the Word of God says, "And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted Him, saying, 'Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?' He said unto him, 'What is written in the law? How readest thou?' And he answering said, 'Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy strength, with all thy mind, and love thy neighbor as thyself.' And Jesus said unto him, 'Thou hast answered right, this do, and thou shalt live.' But he," the lawyer, the man who was tempting Jesus, I want you to keep that in the back of your mind, that this man was not necessarily sincerely inquiring about his salvation, but he was rather tempting Jesus, is what Luke tells us. "But he," verse 29, "willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, 'And who is my neighbor?' And Jesus answering said, 'A certain man," I want you to get that tonight, "a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment, and wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance there came down a certain priest that way, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And likewise a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him, and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion upon him, and went to where he was, bound up his wounds, pouring in the oil and the wine, and setting him on his own beast, and brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And on the morrow when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to host, and said unto him, 'Take care of him, and whatsoever thou spendest when I come again, I will repay thee.' Which now of these three, thinkest thou, lawyer, was the neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves?" And he said, "He that showed mercy upon him." Then said Jesus unto him, "Go and do thou likewise." And I want to minister, I promise I won't try to keep you long tonight, but I want to minister a message tonight simply entitled, "A Certain Man and a Certain Samaritan." A certain man and a certain Samaritan. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word tonight. Father, I thank you for the anointing of your Holy Spirit, Lord, that I sense and I feel, Lord, even now, Father. Father, I thank you, Lord, for the liberty, for the freedom that we have as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, I ask you tonight, Lord, that you would add your blessing to the reading, to the study of your word, Father. I ask for Holy Ghost conviction tonight, Lord, to move and to sweep across, Lord, this place tonight. Father, I ask for Holy Ghost conviction, O God, upon every heart and every life in this place, O God. I ask for Holy Ghost strength and anointing tonight, Lord, as we minister your word, Lord, and not for myself only, Lord, but I ask for the anointing to rest upon those who sit under the sound of our voices tonight, Lord, that the Spirit of God, Lord, would go forth and would begin to prick the hearts of your people tonight, Lord, whether they be saved or unsaved. Father, we ask for the anointing of the Holy Spirit, Lord, the one who makes preaching what it ought to be, Lord God. For without your Spirit, Lord, without your grace, without your anointing, Lord, little or nothing can be done for the kingdom of God, Lord. So we ask tonight for the anointing. We expect the anointing, Lord God. We're expecting you, God, to move tonight, Lord, not because of who we are, Lord, but because your word testifies, Lord, that when your word goes forth, that the Holy Spirit will go to work. And Father, we're asking for that tonight, Lord. And we'll be sure when it's all said and done, as we do now, to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said amen and amen. This lawyer at this time in Jesus' ministry had come to Jesus, and the Bible says that this lawyer, I won't keep you long tonight, but the Bible says that this lawyer came to Jesus and he began to tempt him and asked the Lord Jesus, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" You must understand that by this time in our Lord's ministry, by this time in Jesus' ministry, his fame had stretched across the regions of Galilee. His fame had stretched across the regions of Israel. His fame and his the things that he did and the words that he said and the way that he moved, the way that he talked, the way that he walked, the way that he healed sickened bodies and opened blinded eyes, the way that he did what he did was being talked about in all of Israel. And there were not many people by this time in his ministry who at least had not heard about Jesus, heard about this man named Jesus who showed up on the scene. And the day that he started his ministry, when he first began his ministry, the man who stood in the synagogue and quoted Isaiah chapter 61 and said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to bring deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." He stood up and said, "This prophecy, written a couple thousand years ago, testified of me, and I am about to prove to you through my earthly ministry that I am the one whom this prophecy testifies about." And not long after he left that synagogue that day, not long after he stood up and quoted Isaiah 61, he began to do exactly what the prophecy said that he would do. He began to preach the gospel. He began to heal the sick. He began to open blinded eyes. He began to do exactly what the Old Testament said that the Messiah would come to do. So at this time, we must understand that Jesus, he is well known of the people in Israel. And there are two sects of people that we will, not two sects, S-E-X, but S-E-C-T-S. There are two groups of people that Jesus would minister to. Number one, he would minister to those who were hurting, those who knew they were lost, those who knew they needed a physician, those who knew that they needed righteousness that they could not procure in and of their own standing. Jesus said that I came to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and I came not to those who were well, but I came to those who were sick. Amen. And in need of a physician. So there were two groups, two sects in Jesus' day. Number one, the people who, when they came in contact with him, realized who he was, realized their unrighteousness, and realized their need for him. And number two, there was a group of religious folk in Israel at this time who, when Jesus would show up on the scene, they would begin to mock him, they would begin to ridicule him, they would begin to doubt him and talk about him. And this lawyer fell into that category. Even though the Bible does not directly say that this man was self-righteous, even though that the Bible does not say that this lawyer said, hey, I'm one of those who don't believe in you, I'm one of those who want to tempt you, I'm one of those who want to speak ill of you, even though the Bible does not directly tell us that, the Bible does tell us about the character of this man. And the character of this man was that of doubt, that of unbelief, and that of self-righteousness. Because when he came to Jesus, he did not come in sincerity desiring eternal life from Jesus. He wanted to know what he could do for himself to earn the salvation that Jesus was saying he could only give. Because the lawgivers and the religious folks of this time, they thought in their mind that there was something that they could merit. They thought that there was something that they could do. They thought that there was something in and of their own strength, in and of their own emotion, in and of their own power that they could do to earn the salvation that only the coming Messiah could give. Every day in Israel, the religious leaders of that day, the men, they would wake up and they would start to thank God. God, I thank you that I'm not a Samaritan. God, I thank you that I'm not a woman. God, I thank you that I'm not like the other sinners who are around me. They were conceited. They were all about themselves. They were worried only about the righteousness that they could produce in and of their own selves. But the Bible clearly tells us through the prophet Isaiah that you and I, as righteousness is as that of filthy rags in the eyes of God. It does not matter how religious, how good it may look on the outside, how nice of a person you may be, how sincere, how this or how that. All of that is repudiating in the eyes of God if our righteousness is not the righteousness of Jesus Christ and what he provided for us at Calvary's cross. So this lawyer in his self-righteousness came to Jesus and said, Jesus, what must I do? You see, the emphasis was on self. And I hate to tell you tonight that it's not only the world in the time in which we are living, it's not only the world who has the emphasis on self, it's now crept into the church. And men who were once men of God are standing behind pulpits and they're saying that there's something that you can do in and of yourself to earn righteousness and salvation from God. That is anathema and that is blasphemy. That is not of God. There's nothing that you and I can do. We live in a time and we live in a day, we live in an hour that many preachers stand behind pulpits and they give us motivational speeches. They give us gospels that will tickle our ears and that they'll we're tiptoeing through the tulips and everything's okay. Don't look at yourself as a bad person. Don't think of your sin. Don't worry about the negativity that's in your life. We've got a lot of preachers saying a lot of good things while people are sitting on the pews living a lot of nasty lives. Amen. And people are being fed the lie that there's something that you can do in and of your own self, in and of your own standing, in and of your own works and righteousness. People are being fed the lie that there's something that you can do in and of yourself to earn the salvation that only Jesus Christ, through what he did at Calvary, can grant you. People are being fed that lie in the time and hour in which we live, and it's obvious. Not by the man's words, because religious folk will never tell you they're religious. Amen, somebody. Amen. Self-righteous folk will never tell you that they are self-righteous. Those who think that they can work for their own salvation will never tell you, hey, I can work for my own salvation. No, self-righteousness is always clothed in a false humility. But eventually, if you hang around them long enough, you're going to find out where the emphasis is in their life. Yes. And the characteristic of a self-righteous person is when the emphasis is more upon myself, what I can do, what I have done, what I will do, rather than God, what He has done, what He is doing, and what He will do. If you get around somebody who's more concerned about their own lives, their own ministries, their own this, their own that, their own everything else, get away from them. Amen. You don't need a part of that.
Amen.
You need people who know that they need a Savior. You need people who daily, day in and day out, realize their need for a Savior, realize their need for the help and the power of the Holy Spirit moving and operating in their lives. So Jesus gives the man the command that if you're going to be righteous, what does the law say you got to do? He questions the man. If you want to be righteous, well, how does the law say that you become righteous? So the man, in his knowledge of the scripture, just because people know scripture doesn't mean people are saved. There's a lot of scholars and professors and preachers who can quote a lot more scripture than you could even quote or you could even think about, but yet they've never been born again. So this man, he knew the law. He knew what the law said, and he told Jesus in his pride and in his boastfulness and in his arrogance, he said, what I can do, what the law says for me to do is to love God with all my mind, all my heart, all my soul, and to love my neighbor as myself. And Jesus said, do this and you will inherit eternal life. But the problem was, you see, Jesus came to confound the wise. Listen to me now. Those who are wise in their own minds, those who are wise in their own hearts, Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 that Jesus came to confound those who thought they were wise. There's a lot of people in the world right now. We live in a society who believes with all of their heart that we're getting smarter and smarter by the day. They think that we're getting wiser and wiser by the day because we're removing God from our society. We're removing God from our school systems. We're removing God from every facet of life. We're getting to a place where our society believes that we don't have to depend on God, on a higher power, for anything in our lives. We're getting to a point in our day, and not only in our society, but I'm sad to say tonight that we're also getting to a place where the church is in the same condition. We're getting to a place to where we're casting God out of what we do. We're not worried about the Holy Ghost. We're not worried about the moving of the Spirit. We're not dependent upon Him. We're not wanting Him. We're not desiring Him. The church is no longer hungry for a move of God like it once was. And so we've built this own frame of our own righteousness, and we've cast God out of our society, and we've got to a place to where for some odd reason we think that as sinful men we could do something in and of ourselves to merit the righteousness, to earn the salvation that God can only give by grace through faith. So the man says, this is what I do. And Jesus said, okay, well, do it. Jesus was confounding him. Jesus knew. Jesus said, before I say that, I want to say this. Jesus said prior in his ministry that I've come not to destroy the law, but I've come to fulfill it. I didn't come to necessarily do away with the law. But you see, the law was given, Romans 5 tells us, the law was given so that sin would abound.
Yep, amen.
That's not what I said. That's what the Bible says. That God gave the law to man so that sin in the heart of man could come to the surface and reveal to man his unrighteousness and his inability to live pleasing and righteously before the law. Because the law said if you break one aspect of the law, you're worthy of death. one aspect of it, and you're worthy of death. So Jesus tells this man, keep the law perfectly, and you can have eternal life. He confounded him. Jesus knew that this man could not keep the law. Jesus knew this man's thoughts. Now, if this man, listen, if this man would have come to Jesus in humble contrition, truly desiring salvation, truly desiring to be saved and changed, Jesus would have said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to God but by me. But Jesus at times would use parables to confound the religious folk, and they would get angry at him because they couldn't understand what he was saying. Because just a few verses before, Jesus told his disciples that you're blessed because you understand and you see things that even the prophets of the Old Testament, even though they prophesied about them, they could not see and they could not understand because they didn't have the same opportunity that you have to be born again and the Spirit of God living on the inside of your soul. So he told his disciples, you're blessed because you can see and understand things that the natural man cannot see and understand. Nicodemus came to Jesus in John chapter 3, and he said, well, he's asked the same question, what must I do to inherit eternal life? But there was a sincere heart there, and Jesus told Nicodemus, you must be born again. That the only way you're going to see, much less inherit, the kingdom of God is that you be born again, that the old man be crucified and the new man be raised to resurrection life by the power of Almighty God. But this man, in his self-righteousness, Jesus knowing that even if he told this man, I'm the way of salvation and only through faith in me can you be saved, Jesus, knowing this man's heart, said, keep the law and you'll be saved. Knowing that this man could not in his own strength keep the law in order to please God. The Bible says in Romans chapter 3 that we all are sinners. And we all fall short of the glory of God. From the highest of the highs, from executives and lawyers and bosses and professors to the lowest of the low in the ghettos and the poor and the broken and the drug addicts and the alcoholics. From that to that and everywhere in between, there is no righteousness in and of our own merit that we have to offer to God.
That's right.
There is no goodness, there is no greatness in and of ourselves. The Bible never said that we were wonderful. The prophet said that he shall be called wonderful. He shall be called counselor. He shall be called the Prince of Peace.
Yes.
So there is no righteousness, there is no goodness in and of ourselves. So this man, continuing on with Jesus in the conversation. Well, Jesus, the Bible says he was arrogant once again in his approach. He was not sincere. He was trying to confound Jesus. How many of you know that's a stupid thing to do? To try to confound God in his own wisdom. So he goes to Jesus and he says, Jesus, who is my neighbor? So first the focus was on, how can I earn eternal life? How can I inherit eternal life? And now he's more worried about who his neighbor is and what he has to do for his neighbor than he is his own lost, sin-sick condition. So Jesus goes on with the story in verse 30, and it says this. And it said, well, verse 29, it says that the lawyer, willing to justify himself, there it is again. First it was, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And now here he is, even though he doesn't say this, the Holy Spirit reads the intents of this man's heart. Because the Holy Ghost is not looking at your outward appearance. God said in 1 Samuel, I don't look at the outward, I look at the inward. So the Holy Ghost reads his mail. Can I tell you tonight that we still serve the same Holy Spirit that read this man's mail 2,000 years ago? Can I tell you right now that the same Holy Spirit who knew the intents of this man's heart, who knew what this man was thinking, who knew how this man was feeling, that the same Holy Spirit of God right now is moving across this room and He knows the intents of every single one of our hearts. You cannot run from the Holy Ghost. David said, if I make my bed in hell, there He is with me trying to get me out. The Holy Ghost will follow you all the way to hell if that's what He's got to do. And He is not going to give up until either you get saved or you die and you burn in a devil's hell. I know that's harsh preaching. I know that's old school preaching, but that's the truth of the Word of God, my brothers and my sisters.
Amen.
That is not some fairy tale that some man made up. That is not some doctrine some preacher came up with. There is still a real heaven, and there is still a very real, a very long, and a very hot hell tonight. There is still a hell that is filled with millions upon millions of men and women who thought that in and of their own righteousness they could do something to earn salvation from God. You see, it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter your last name. It doesn't matter how old or how young. It does not matter who your mama is, who your daddy is. It doesn't matter even what church you go to. It does not matter. The Holy Ghost is looking for your soul.
That's it.
Yeah.
How about your heart? Is it right with God? I'm not asking how are your actions. I'm not asking how are your deeds. I'm not asking you how many good things do you do on the job or at school or at work or whatever. I'm not asking that. I'm asking you tonight under the anointing of the Holy Ghost, how is your heart tonight? Is your heart like this man, ready to justify yourself? Or is your heart broken and mended before God, saying, God, there was nothing I could do to save myself on the first day, and there's nothing in and of my own power I can do now to keep myself in this thing called salvation? I'm here to stir your hearts tonight. I'm on a rescue mission tonight, and I'm here to ask you, how is your heart? Where is your soul tonight? Can I tell you tonight that if you've not said yes to Jesus, that your soul is as this man and it's hanging in the balance, and at any moment in time, your last breath can be breathed, your heart can stop beating, your lungs can stop breathing, and at that very moment, when it happens, whenever it happens, because you're not promised tomorrow, when it happens and it will happen, when it happens and it will happen, when it happens, the moment you take your last breath, you will end up in eternity, a never-ending place called either heaven or hell.
Amen.
How is your heart tonight? Have you lived your whole life trying to justify yourself? Have you lived your whole life like this lawyer, thinking that in and of yourself you're righteous, thinking that in and of yourself you're good, thinking that there was something you can do on the outward to please the God of heaven and earth? Look deep into your heart tonight. Inspect that old heart of yours. Jeremiah the prophet, all the way in the Old Testament, said that no man knows the heart of the old man. That the heart is wicked. It's desperately wicked, the prophet said, that no man can know it. That the heart of man is so wicked that you yourself, without the Holy Spirit conviction of God coming upon you, you yourself do not know how wicked your heart really is.
Amen.
Without the Holy Spirit of God moving upon you, wooing you and drawing you to Jesus, you don't know how wicked and how desperately far away from God that you really are. There is a gulf tonight between man and God. And the only way that we can reach across that gulf, the only way that we can span the measures of that gulf, is through the righteousness of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And so the only way that you can know the wickedness of your heart, the only way that you can know that you're unsaved and you've been your whole life depending upon your good works, depending upon your good looks, depending upon your good efforts, the only way that you can truly see the awful and the wretched condition of your heart is that the Holy Ghost of God reveal that evil and that wickedness to you.
Yes.
And while this man, this lawyer, was trying to earn salvation himself, while this man, this lawyer, was trying to justify himself, while this man and while this lawyer was more worried about what he could do for his neighbor, Jesus then begins to confound him. And what he shows the man is not that that man can achieve salvation. What he shows the man is not that he can earn anything from God. What he shows that man is the awful and desperate condition of mankind lost without God. He shows him the awful and the desperate condition of mankind without God. And verse number 30 in Luke chapter 10 says this: "And Jesus answering said, a certain man went down." Listen to me. "A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho." The fact that Jesus calls him a certain man tells me that God knows each and every individual in this earth by name. God knows the number of hairs that are on your head or the lack thereof. He knows who you are. He knows where you're from. He knows the hurt and the pain. He knows the goodness of your life. He knows the badness of your life. He knows the good times and the bad times. Jesus said, a certain man. Jesus knows every man. God the Father in heaven knows every man as their own person. That tells me not at any time can I depend upon someone else for my relationship with God. That I as an individual am accountable for my relationship with God. I myself as an individual am accountable for the salvation that Jesus freely offered me. He said a certain man went down. From Jerusalem to Jericho. That tells me that this certain man was a Jew. Because if anybody was traveling to Jerusalem as a visitor, it would have said that they traveled from such and such to Jerusalem. But it says that this certain man traveled from. He was from Jerusalem. He was a Jew. And he went down into Jericho. He went down into Jericho. And it says this, that he fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance, there came down a certain priest that way. And when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And likewise, a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him and passed by on the other side. And now the Bible tells us in Luke chapter 10, verse number 33, that a certain Samaritan. So right now you have a Jew lying in a ditch, beat up and robbed and bruised and tattered and torn. A Jew laying in a ditch, beat up, battered, bruised and torn. And you've got a Samaritan whom the Jews hated. Listen to me now. You've got a Jew in the ditch, beat up, battered, bruised, and torn, and you've got a Samaritan. A Jew in the ditch and a Samaritan walking alongside the road on his own journey. A Samaritan whom the Jews hated. Can I tell you tonight that what Jesus was trying to illustrate, that what Jesus was trying to show this lawyer, this man that night, was that his condition was that of the certain man who came from Jerusalem to Jericho? He was trying to show the lawyer that your spiritual condition is no better than a physical man who came down from Jerusalem to Jericho and got beat up by thieves, got robbed by thieves, got thrown into the ditch by thieves. He's trying to show this man that in and of yourself, you are nothing in the eyes of God. In and of yourself, you're nothing better than sin sick, sin depraved. You're rotten, you're wretched, you're rotten at the very core. And in and of yourself, there's nothing you can do to get out of the ditch. And unless somebody else comes along and rescues you out of the ditch that you're in, you'll never have hope for eternal life. That's what Jesus was portraying to this man. So this certain man, this Jew that came down from Jerusalem to Jericho represents mankind as a whole. Represents you and I, lost without God. You and I on our way to hell. You and I without Jesus under the curse of sin, under the penalty of sin, under the power of sin. You and I lost, beat up and tattered and torn by the powers of sin, needing someone to come along and to rescue us. You and I tonight were the certain man. And maybe there's one or two in here tonight that you are the certain man. You're beat up and you're tattered and you're bruised by sin, and you don't know how to get out of the spiritual ditch that you're in. You don't know how to get out of this spiritual depravity, this sin-sick world, this sin-sick life that you find yourself in, and you've exhausted all of your own labors. You've tried to earn your own righteousness. You've tried to earn your salvation. You've tried to earn your way out of this bondage of sin that you find yourself in. And I came to tell you tonight that you are just as this certain man who was lost and bound and beat up in the ditch and could not do anything for himself. Amen. That's you and I before we said yes to Jesus. We were that certain man, beat up, broken by the power of sin, broken by Satan and his minions, bruised and tattered, left hopeless, left waste with not anything that we could do for ourselves. A certain man lying in a ditch, broken and bound by sin. Do you remember what it was like? I remember going to bed in fear, waking up in fear, going to bed helpless, waking up helpless, going to bed hopeless, waking up hopeless. Oh, by God, but one day a Samaritan came walking my way, and he didn't leave me beat up and bruised and tattered and torn in that ditch of bondage and sin. It wasn't because of my goodness or my merit. It was because of his grace. I'm trying to start a fire in your hearts tonight through the power of the Holy Ghost. I pray that a fire of conviction would rain down in your heart, and that you would once again become to get excited about the salvation that you have. This salvation, Hebrews 2 said, is not a low salvation. It's not just an okay salvation. It's not a medium salvation. The writer of Hebrews said, we have a great salvation.
Yeah.
Where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. Amen. You say, preacher, how do you know that when Jesus said a certain Samaritan, that he was talking about himself. I'm going to tell you why. Because at this time, like I said, the Jews despised the Samaritan people. But yet when this Samaritan walked by, even though he knew that this man in the ditch hated him, he still went to where he was. My God, did you hear what I just said? The Bible says, the prophet Isaiah tells us in Isaiah chapter 53 that he was Jesus the Messiah. He was despised and rejected. My God, did you hear what I said? He was despised and rejected of men. He was a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He says it again. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Just like the Jew 2,000 years ago did to the Samaritans of that day, the Jews despised the Samaritans so much so that they esteemed the Samaritans as dogs. And that's the condition of the heart of fallen man. That was the condition of our heart before salvation. We despised the very one who Amen. Could come to save us.
Amen.
So the Samaritan represented Jesus walking to a people, seeing a people who despised him, seeing a people who hated him, seeing a people who wanted nothing to do with him, yet having compassion. The book of John chapter 1 and verse 11 says that he came to his own and his own received him not, but he still came. John chapter 1 and verse 11. He came to his own and his own received him not. I'm talking about the Samaritan again. That the Samaritan came to this man, even knowing that on a natural day, on a good day, this man would never receive him. That on a good day, this man would never accept him. But this man had gotten to such a place in his life, such a low place. God had humbled him to such a degree that at this time, anyone who would help him, he was willing to say, "Help me." God had humbled him to such a degree that this man, when the Samaritan came by, did not deny his help, even though he despised him, even though he esteemed him as nothing greater than a dog. Yet when he came by that day that he was broken and bruised and tattered by the power of sin, he did not reject the help that the Samaritan reached out to give him. I'm telling you about Jesus tonight.
Amen.
The Holy Ghost of God is convicting hearts and saying that lost and without God, you're nothing better than this Jew lying in a ditch, beaten and battered and torn. You say, how else do I know that this Samaritan represented Jesus? Because the Bible tells us in verse 33 that this Samaritan, he was a Samaritan. He was a certain Samaritan. He was the one whom the Jews despised. But it also says this Samaritan, as he journeyed. Listen to me now. As he journeyed. He was not in need of stopping to help that man. He was on his own journey. He could have walked right by that man, just like the priest did, just like the Levite did. Why? Because in his own right, there was no reason that he should reach out to this Jew that hated him and despised him. There was no reason that he should have reached out to this Jew. So as he journeyed, the Bible says that this Samaritan had compassion and he went. Can I tell you tonight that Jesus, in all of his grandeur and glory, in all of his goodness and royal, and all of his greatness as a king, that he did not have to humble himself and come to the cross to save you and I. He did not have to come to this world to save a people who rejected him, who despised him, who did not even esteem him. The Bible tells us in Romans chapter 1 that men don't even like to retain God in their knowledge. In their own knowledge, they would rather boot God out of the door, but yet the Holy Ghost is searching and moving, and He will not leave the hearts of men alone. He did not have to come to the cross, but when He was on the cross, you were on His mind.
Thank God. Amen.
When He was on the cross, He was not thinking about Himself. He was not thinking about His glory and His grandeur. He was thinking about lost humanity. And as this Samaritan was on his own journey, even though on his own journey, even though in his own right, he didn't have to stop, still he decided to have compassion upon this man, even though this man hated him, even though this man despised him. By God, I feel that tonight. Even though this man hated him, he still had compassion upon him. And even when we did not retain God in our knowledge, God still, from before the foundation of the world, went and took the penalty for your sin. Even when He didn't have to, He did it anyway. Even when He didn't want to, He did it anyway. Even when He was innocent and righteous and holy, even when He didn't have to do it, He did it anyway. Why? Because John 3:16 tells us why. For God so loved the world. That's why He did it. His love nailed Him to the tree. His love is what held Him there. His love is what kept Him there. His love is what allowed Him to suffer and to be despised and to drink the cup of the wrath of God. Oh my God, it was His love that kept Him on that tree. At any moment in time, He could have called, the Bible says, 10,000 angels to come and to rescue Him. And even religious man was looking at Him and saying, hey, call on your God to rescue you. But no, He laid His pride and His power aside and said, I'm not doing this for the sake of myself. I'm doing this for the souls of mankind. I'm doing it for the souls of mankind. So this man, as he journeyed, he stopped and he had compassion upon this man who was bruised, beat up, tattered, and torn. Had compassion upon him. And he went to where he was. We didn't go to where God was because we couldn't get to where He was. So when we couldn't get to where He was, He came to where we were.
Amen.
And He took upon Himself, the Bible says that He who knew no sin became sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God. It was never about Himself. The writer of Hebrews says that for the joy set before Him, glory to God. I feel that tonight. I don't know if you feel the presence of God like I feel, but I feel God in this place tonight. And that for the joy set before Him, what was the joy set before Him? Why, what joy would cause Him to endure the cross of Calvary? What joy would cause Him not for His life to be taken? His life was not taken. His life was freely given.
Amen.
Jesus said, you can try to take my life, but you can't. You're not going to be able to do it. But I'm going to give my life, and in 3 days I'm going to raise it back up again. So He had the power to lay His life down. And even after laying His life down, He had the power to raise it up. What joy, what love would cause this man of Galilee, this man who was despised and rejected, this man who men mocked and ridiculed all the days of his life, what joy would cause him to allow the nails to be pierced in his hands? What joy would allow this man to lay on the ground and be beaten by a whip, a cat of nine tails, full of glass and rock and rubble and things that would literally rip your flesh apart? What joy and what love would cause a man to do such a thing? The joy was knowing the joy that it would bring to his Father. Because God, from the beginning of time, desired relationship with his creation.
Yes. Amen.
And the only way that a holy, a thrice holy God could be in relation with sin-sick, sin-filled, sin-dominated man is that someone would come and take their place. Someone would come and pay the price that they themselves deserved to pay. Would come and nail themselves to a cross, presenting themselves to God as a righteous and holy sacrifice for sin. That was the only way that God would ever be able to be in relationship with his creation again. You see, God doesn't want to save you just so that you can say, "Hey, I'm saved." Listen to me now. He wants to save you because he wants to know you. He wants to save you because he wants to be in relationship with you. He wants to save you because he wants to pour his love upon you. The church is so focused on what we can do for God. But the Apostle John said, the only reason we love him is because he first loved us. And where did he prove his love for us? At Calvary's cross. At the cross of Calvary. At the cross where I first saw the light. And the burden of my heart was rolled away. It was there by faith that I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. He saved me, but he didn't just save me just for the thought or the fact of saving me. He washed my sins away. The Bible says that this Samaritan bound the wounds and he poured in the oil and the wine. One of my favorite songs, old time song, I've been singing it since I was a kid. He poured in the oil and the wine, the kind that restoreth my soul.
Yes.
He found me bleeding and dying on that Jericho road, and he poured in the oil and the wine. You see, I was bleeding. You hear the song, right? The correlation. I was bleeding and dying.
Amen.
On that Jericho road.
Amen.
But yet, a certain Samaritan.
Yes.
I was the certain man.
Yes.
Hear me tonight. I was that certain man who came down from Jerusalem to Jericho. Came down. Yes. I was down. I was under the bondage of sin. Mankind was once in right relationship, but because of the fall, man went down.
Yes.
Man lost the goodness and the fellowship, the righteousness that he once had because of sin. But he didn't leave me there.
Amen.
I was that certain man. I was that certain Jew that thought I could achieve salvation and righteousness in and of my own standard. I was that certain man. But one day, by the grace of God, there came a certain Samaritan. One who was despised and one who was rejected. I know my voice is gone, but I've got to sing it again. He poured in the oil and the wine, the kind that restoreth my soul. If you're saved tonight, just lift your hands right now. He found me bleeding and dying on that Jericho road. And he poured in the oil and the wine. One more time. He poured in the oil and the wine. The kind that restoreth my soul. He found me bleeding and dying on that Jericho road. And he poured in the oil and the wine. What's the oil and the wine?
It's
It's the blood of Jesus and the power of the Holy Ghost. He didn't just wash me of my sins, but when I said yes to Jesus, He came to live inside of me. I came to tell you tonight that if you are saved, you do not serve a dead and buried God. Yes, Muhammad is dead and buried. Yes, Buddha is dead and buried. But if you go to Jerusalem and you look for the tomb of a man named Jesus Christ, you will find that that tomb is empty, because after He died, because He was the perfect sacrifice, He did not stay dead, but He rose from the dead so that He could put His resurrection power and His Holy Ghost to live on the inside of you.
Amen.
The wine picturing the blood of Jesus, the wine, the strong wine, was that they didn't have medicine in that day. So they had to use alcohol to clean cuts, to clean wounds. They had to use strong alcohol to get the infection out of bruises and out of cuts and out of thorns and so on and so forth. They had to use strong alcohol. Can I tell you that it took a strong blood? It took a pure blood. It took a righteous blood. It took a blood that would be strong and effective to take away, to wash away, to remove the infection of sin that was in our lives. It took the blood of Jesus. It took a holy lamb. It took a spotless lamb. It took a pure lamb. It took a lamb's blood that was innocent, spotless, but yet powerful to take the infection of sin away. And then after they would put the strong wine in to take the infection out, they would then apply the oil. They would put the oil upon the cut so that the cut would not only be clean, but so that the cut could be protected. My God, not only so that the cut could be clean, but so that the cut could be protected and so that the cut could heal. Listen to me now, could heal as it needed to heal. Let me tell you, even though you may be saved tonight, there's still some things on the inside of you that you need God to heal. And I'm here by the grace of God to declare, notice on the devil, that I can be healed tonight. I can be made new. I can have victory over sin. I can live at peace. I can have joy and hope and restoration and power, all because the oil is being poured into my life. All because the oil is on the inside of me. All because the Holy Ghost is living on the inside of me. But He didn't stop there. The Bible says He bound the wounds, poured in the oil and the wine, and I'm done. I'm closing. I'm trying to quit. The Bible says this, that He set him, He set the certain man on His own beast. On His own. The Samaritan gave him what was rightfully his, but he gave it to him to do with it what he needed to do. Right now, this man needed to get to an inn, to a hotel, so that he could rest, that he could be comforted, that he could be taken care of. Can I tell you tonight that God, in salvation, gave you His own beast, gave you His own measures, gave you His own gifts, gave you His own blessings to get you to where you need to go? Don't be discouraged. Don't be despaired. God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, has given you what you need to make it. Given you His own resources for you to use to get where He knows you need to go. Do not worry. Do not be discouraged. My God shall supply all of my needs according to His riches, which be in glory by Christ Jesus. How does He give us the riches? By Christ. Through Christ.
Amen.
Through Christ and what He's done for us at the cross. After he set him on his own beast, the Samaritan brought the certain man to an inn, and he took care of him. You hear what I said? He brought him to a safe dwelling place, and he took care of him. God will take care of you. Listen to me, Christian believer. God will take care of you.
Amen.
God has provided, God is providing, and God shall provide.
Amen.
Abraham, by experience, learned that his father was Jehovah Jireh, the Lord, my provider. He's going to take care of you. Jesus said, if my father cares for the little sparrow that falls from the tree, if he cares for that, an animal, a thing that contains no soul, if he cares for that, how much more does he care for you? And he not only cares for the sparrow, but he sees to it that the sparrow is taken care of in that their needs are met. He gives them sustenance to feed upon. He gives them water to drink, food to eat, a nest to keep their hens and to lay in and to be protected. He gives them, he cares for them, and he takes care of them. God cares for you tonight. If you're saved, he's going to take care of you. Mark my words. He's bound to it because his word says that he will do it.
Amen.
I came to tell you tonight that you and I were the certain man. If you're saved tonight, you and I were the certain man. Paul said we were in bondage. We were under sin. We were children of wrath. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, gave himself as a ransom. And that's why we can say we were that. But maybe tonight, as your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, I want you to bow your heads and close your eyes tonight. But maybe tonight, you say, I am a certain man. I am that one who is in the ditch right now. I realize I'm not saved. I realize I haven't made things right with God. I've been trying to perform. I've been trying to achieve righteousness and help in my own right and in my own measure, but I can't find the way to do it. And you say, I've lived my whole life thinking that I'm okay because I've done good things, because I've made a lot of money, because I'm a good person. Maybe that's you. And tonight the Holy Spirit of God has pricked your heart. And you say, I realize that I'm in the condition that that certain man was in. Beat up, bruised, and tattered. And I can't do anything to receive God myself. I can't do anything to be saved myself. If you say that's you tonight, I won't embarrass you. I promise. I give you my word, I will not embarrass you tonight. I just want you to lift your hand where you are. Nobody's looking. Nobody's looking around. I want you to just lift your hand and say, that's me. I promise you, I will not embarrass you. I give you my word tonight. But you say, you know what? I don't know if I'm saved. I may be just like that certain man on my way to hell, and I don't know that I'm saved. I don't know for sure that if I died tonight on the way home, God forbid, get in a car wreck, God forbid, die some kind of way, I don't know if I would make heaven my home. If that's you, I just want you to lift your hand. Let's all stand together tonight. I'm going to pray a prayer. Know this, praying a prayer, simply praying a prayer, will not save you. A man, I cannot save you. Whether you raised your hand or not, that does not determine your salvation. What determines your salvation at this moment in this hour is, have you realized that you are that certain man in the ditch? You realize that you are that one, helpless, hopeless, and in need of a good Samaritan to come alongside of you and to help you, to bind up the wounds of sin and to fill you with His Holy Spirit, to fill you with the life of God. It's nothing you can achieve in and of your own self. And saying a prayer, talking to a man cannot do it. But being sincere before God, realizing your sinfulness and realizing your need, and saying, God, I realize, yes, that I'm a sinner, I'm under the curse, I'm under the penalty of sin, but I also realize that a certain man, that a Samaritan, has come walking my way. And I want to reach out to that Samaritan and be saved. I want us to bow our heads once again and we're going to pray together. I'm just going to pray this prayer, and if that's you, I want you just to repeat this prayer. I want all of us, all of you, everyone, to repeat after me as I pray this prayer. That way, if there be someone, we give them strength by prayer. Like I said, praying a prayer will not save you, but it's believing, realizing your need for a Savior, and believing in your heart that Jesus has come to save you. That's what will save you tonight. And that's what will cause the Good Samaritan to come, to bind up the wounds of sin and to pour in the oil. Just repeat after me. Dear God in heaven,
dear God in heaven,
I come to you,
I come to you
in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
I realize today
my sin-sick condition.
I realize that in my own strength,
I cannot
be pleasing,
in
your eyes.
I realize
that I have been beat up, tattered,
bruised,
and torn by sin. But I also realize that Jesus has come to my rescue to bind up the wounds and to pour in His life. And today, I ask you to forgive me of my sin. Cleanse me from all unrighteousness. I confess that Jesus Christ is the Savior of my soul. I believe that God raised Jesus from the dead and He is alive. I believe that now I am washed, I am cleansed, I am forgiven, I am saved. Praise God. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise tonight. I want you to know, if that's you tonight and you prayed that prayer, like I said, praying the prayer won't do it. But it's realizing you're that certain man and realizing the Samaritan has come to your rescue. I want you to know that God says that you are a new creation in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Old things have passed away and now all things are become new. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray.